so much for joining us on Around the Peninsula. I'm Maria Serrao. Today we take you to an extraordinary place at the Los Angeles International Airport. The USO at LAX serves millions of military men and women who serve our country. The volunteers take very good care of our military and they need your help. Here's more on the USO at LAX.
I know every day is different here. Tell us what it's like maybe on just a typical day being here when the Marines come in.
Typical day. Wow. It changes so drastically, but basically it's just prepping for the arrival of them on Tuesdays in particular. We do get a count generally 24 hours before. We have a special volunteer that follows up with the 29 Palms in Camp Pendleton to get the exact head count that's coming. Then we send it on out to all the volunteers to prep them. I order barbecue the night before because we do get people hosting it for us. And just prepping for the day, making sure everything is stocked, that we've got plenty of food, that the place is clean, and just getting everybody ready to accept them here. Yeah.
You know, it's kind of amazing because these guys do so much for us, and they're so appreciative of the fact that they get to come to a place that feels like home to them. Talk about that.
Well, the first part of it, though, is what you said is they're so appreciative. They are actually stunned that we are volunteering. They find that amazing. And here we are saying, but you're volunteering for something far greater. So that gratitude, you will never get such gratitude going around like in a circle back and forth with what they do. And it's just, it's very hard to describe. I consider it an honor and a privilege that I get to be here in that environment and just show some sort of gratitude to them. And I know all the volunteers here, it's your favorite part of the day. And for me, like I said, I get to do it every day. So it's even better. Well, we just try and, have the atmosphere as if you were home. Would you have particular, bowls for, football season and the food? We always have hot dogs. That's a huge thing here at the center. Chili dogs, peanut butter and jelly is a big hit, believe it or not. The things that you really take for granted, they value it so much. And they just love it. They love they can come here and relax and, watch TV, sleep, take a nap, shower, and just have that really nice environment. And it doesn't cost them anything. When they're straight in, they don't make a lot of money. So they really, really appreciate it.
I was going to kind of go to that. I noticed in the bathrooms there's toothbrushes, toothpaste. Can people donate that? How do you get it?
Absolutely. We have a wish list that's also online, as well as here in the center. When anybody ever asks me, I tell them, imagine camping and you have no water and no electricity. What are you going to do? So those are the things that they need, and it is on the wish list. So we take all those things gladly. We take them in and accept them, and they go out very quickly. It doesn't stay long here.
Tuesdays are very busy days at the USO. I had a chance to sit down with some service men and women who talk about how appreciative they are of the volunteers and what they do.
Well, as United States Marines, coming into a USO, it's really great to have random volunteers welcoming you with open arms. Basically having a home away from home. You're tired, you're hungry, and you need a place to stay. And this is the first place that they send you to. And you walk in and you can smell the food. It smells great. There's video games, there's TV, and whatever you may need, it's all here. And it's all at your discretion. It's great to just have people here that are your friends, and it's just really great. The volunteers are amazing.
It's really nice just to come and be greeted like open-armed. Like you come in and everybody's all smiles, and it's warming. It's like homey. It's like going to your aunt's house or your grandma, whoever's that one person in your family that you go, and they've always got like a pie cooking and food on the table for when you get there.
And what kind of food did you guys have today? It looked pretty good. It smells awfully good.
I had ribs, coleslaw, and some cornbread and some baked beans. But there was also some chicken and some other stuff. So, there was a whole variety of whatever I could want.
What do you like to do while you're here?
It depends on how long I'm waiting. Like, my flight isn't until like 22:50, so I'll be waiting a long time. I'll probably take a nap, maybe watch a movie. I don't know. I'll be here a long time, so I have a lot of stuff I can do.
They greet you kindly. They're nice people. They tell you, where, what to do, So for this one, we marked our bags, and they said they have food for us, and we can relax till our flight takes off. And we pretty much get to relax in here, talk to very kind people and other Marines, and we all get to chit and chat until our flight takes off, and we all can just kind of hang out in here, so it's kind of nice.
Very nice. And then what did they have for you for lunch today?
I had a sandwich. They had ribs and all that kind of stuff. I didn't eat that kind of stuff, though.
It seems like there's a lot of other stuff, too. We were noticing there's donuts, chocolate, all kind of things.
Yeah, there is. There's a lot of stuff. Try and fatten us up.
And so you said that you have quite a long time before your flight takes off?
About 8 hours, yes.
Okay. And so what will you do? I know some people leave or some people just kind of hang out. What's your plan?
I'm looking towards just hanging in here, being on the computer, eating, and enjoying my time here while I can.
Many of the items we take for granted on a daily basis are more than meaningful to a soldier, so sponsorships are very important to keep the center up and running.
Delta Airlines, Northrop, Delaware North, the Gary Sinise Foundation, Jersey Mike's is a big one. Starbucks donates quite a bit to us, as well as Susie Cakes. We get Dunkin' Donuts, the Hudson Group. They are the kiosks within the airport, and they do a drive, and so they give us phone cards so that they can do long-distance calling and so forth. That's just some of them.
I notice a lot of computers and things like that. Is that something that is donated as well?
Almost, really, about 90% of the things that you'll see around the center are donated. We recently got from the WASH group, which is multi-family organization is what they're called, basically. They donated us a brand new washer and dryer, $3,500, commercial grade. We just got a new refrigerator for additional fresh storage. Towels, blankets, you know, get donated. Everything is pretty much donated here, as much as possible. The televisions, the computers, all those things are donated, or we get grants that are written to give us that.
Now, in addition to sponsoring lunch, many Delta crew members come over and serve lunch while visiting with our servicemen and women.
Delta, the community outreach, sponsors this catered lunch every month for them. We bring in all the food, and then volunteers hit and serve the young men and women as they finished up basic training and they're heading out on assignments tonight. So they kind of around the airport for the day or for the afternoon, and it gives a chance to get a little bit of food into them, a little bit of different food than maybe Chow Hall Marine food. And so usually they're usually hit it pretty hard, and they usually seem to enjoy it. I think I've been here every month since June for this, and you know, Delta encourages it. Flight operations and in-flight have been a part of it, and it's just a chance to give back. I'm a former veteran, and it's a chance to see these young Marines and come through everything. It's real inspiring to do and a lot of fun to come. So
you know, it's interesting because in addition to your regular jobs, you have to know how to serve food too, right?
And in my case, I don't know. They keep me far away from the food, but I can go out there and hand out baggage tags and direct the Marines where to store the bags and how to get them set up here. I'm probably better at that.
Yeah, I was going to ask, do you get a chance to talk to the Marines while you're here?
Absolutely. It's fun to welcome them. It comes in a big rush, but when we get a chance, it's fun to see where they're from and where they're going. Because they head out on flights all over the country to their follow-on training assignment. And so usually it's like, welcome to LA, guys. How you doing? Where are you off to? And they'll tell you, I'm going off to mechanic school, or I'm going off to infantry, or I'm going off to whatever specialty school they're going to. They're very excited about it. And usually you can find out what part of the country they're going to. Oh, you're going to have a great time in Florida or in Virginia or Columbus or wherever they're going off to.
You know, it's kind of cool because you guys actually go to all these places. This is so you know about that.
And actually, Rick could be flying them tonight, you know, at various times. But yes, so I've been to most of the places where they talk about their bases are. And I've been on the bases when in my former time in the military. So I've been to many of the bases that they are going to off to.
Being a volunteer is a labor of love, and you can feel the love all the way around when you walk in the building.
It's just, it's an incredible feeling. I don't think you can get this kind of feeling really anywhere else, where there's such appreciation that each person exists, you know, and that the most basic things in life really matter, and it's those things that count. So yeah, it goes a long way. And we have such a strong support system, not only from the volunteers, but LA World Airports is a huge sponsor of, you know, the organization here, and they look out for us all the time. The LA World Airports police department. That's huge, checking in on us. So yeah, it's just a really great environment.
My background is in personnel, and I enjoy finding people jobs. So this is finding people jobs, except they don't get paid.
Yes.
And so I started helping her, and then I, about a year and a half after I started doing the volunteer coordination. We don't do any advertising really, but I get all of the applications, and I call everybody, talk to them, basically do an interview over the phone, let them know what openings that we have. In order to become a volunteer, there has to be an opening. And then I do the training. It's a 4-hour one-on-one training session, and then the rest of the learning is basically on the job with the other volunteers.
Yeah, I was going to ask you that. What is the training? What does that include?
It's different for different people. We have people who have a military background. Either they grew up in, their parents were in the military, or they were in the military, so they have a better, or they're a spouse. So they have a little bit better understanding than someone who has never been in the military. And we do have those types of volunteers as well. A lot of the people we get, maybe their child has gone into the military and they want to give back in some way, or they're a spouse or retired military. So part of the training is learning about the different IDs, the military IDs, because we allow in active duty, retired military, and reservists and their dependents, as well as active military from foreign countries. And so they all have a different military ID. So part of that is learning what those IDs look like. We always ask, where are you headed? What time is your flight? What can we do for you? So that's a big part of the training, is learning about what we can do and also what we can't do. So then it's also learning about the kitchen and where things are and how we make sandwiches and what we have available, and also cleaning the facility up and what we do with that. So it is a learning process, but most of the learning, the training, is about the front desk and the resources that we have available, and the types of information that we need to get from people when they come in.
It's 4-hour shifts, 24 hours a day. Once in a while, we'll get volunteers that will do a shift back to back, depending on what the need is, but it is 4-hour shifts. Yeah.
During the week, we have 3 to 4 during the day. The shifts at night, the 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. and the 2 a.m. to 6 a.m., we have 2 people on a shift.
And where are you most in need?
Probably the 2 a.m. to 6 a.m. shift is the one that we need the most people. Usually those volunteers come in every other week or every third week, depending on the day of the week and the shift. So it's not every week. And it's usually part of that time can be pretty quiet, and then part of that time can be very busy. So we never can predict. People are very good. We rarely have someone who doesn't come in when they're supposed to be there for their shift. So people are very dedicated. And we don't have a lot of people leave because they don't want to leave. Maybe they're leaving because they're moving out of state, or, you know, they have to take care of a sick parent or something like that. But people don't leave because they don't like volunteering. Everybody loves it. But the 2 a.m. shift is probably the one that has the most burnout, just because it's hard on your body.
Sure.
But we do have people who love being up at that time of night, and thank goodness for them, because I'm not one of them.
What's different when a family comes through?
Well, a lot of times they're transitioning. It can be either leaving from the States, going to a foreign country, or vice versa. So it can be a little bit more stressful for them. So that one is really important. And when you get the moms traveling by themselves with the kids, so we really reach out to them and, you know, really help them. Many a times we'll walk over to the terminals, help them go over there, load to the aircraft, you know, we are in touch with the airlines quite a bit, and they really appreciate us helping them out and alerting them when there's, you know, military movement. So we get it's a give and take very well. Yeah.
Yeah, we noticed that because we picked this room. This is the family room, and it's right. Pretty cool.
Yeah, it is. This was painted by Northrop, by the employees. Okay. And they do a huge amount. Like I said, Northrop Corporation themselves, but the employees do fundraising constantly for us. They do little carnivals and just little contests with each other. And it's amazing the amount of donations we get from them. It really is.
Good. We need to keep them coming.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Unfortunately, there's never enough. There really isn't. It's a constant flow. And so because we're 100% nonprofit, you know, and donation driven, it's very important. Yeah.
Jasmine, we noticed that you came in with your family and your kids and your husband. Tell us about coming here to the USO and what you do when you stop through.
It's just nice to come here after a long flight or to wait for my family to get here after their flight. And they always feed us, and everything's free, which is really nice for us and convenient.
I noticed the kids enjoy it, too. It's sort of like a home for them, huh?
Yes, they already know where to go. They know that there's a playroom. They can go play with the toys and read the books, so they're like home.
All of our volunteers are wonderful, and they're just a great group of people. They're dedicated and love what they do, so, and it shows in how they treat our guests.
How did you get involved in all this?
Well, you know, I actually took a leadership course, some training, several years ago, and I myself am a Navy brat from way back, and I didn't realize how much I enjoyed that and valued, you know, growing up in that environment. And I just found out it was a huge passion of mine. So I started volunteering. I just called up. A slot was open because it's not just something you walk into. You have to qualify. And started volunteering on Wednesday nights from 6 to 10. And then this opportunity presented itself, and I threw my hat into the arena, and magic, I got it.
What is the toughest part of your job?
The toughest part of my job? I'm not sure there's a tough part. I would say making myself go home. Making myself go home. Yeah. I stay here a lot, you know, but I really, really enjoy it. And I have friends and family, but I really love being here. I really do.
Well, they say there's no place like home, but the USO at LAX comes pretty close. And if you would like to volunteer, you can check out the website for more information at bobhopeuso.org. I'm Maria Serrao, and we'll see you next time around the peninsula.
Next one. Sorry.